called thali has been constituted, the histories of burger coming to India, say for example, or dabi bibi. And I was talking to a poet, Bill Wallach.
So next part of our panel, which is, we're actually going to read poems, and I hope we hear many languages jostling about, sloshing about in this beautiful ambiance of Prabodh. Gujarati ma vanjo, please.
Yes, yes.
Thank you. Gujarati pun avade chhe. Bahu saari rehte. Kannad, Gujarati.
Hello. Yeah. This is uncanny. I'll tell you why. When I wrote about my infatuation with jazz and beer and Sada Dosa, it was a way of telling myself and the world that it's all about an unresolved anarchy and chaos that one carries within oneself. It wasn't being a hedonist, it wasn't seeking pleasure at any cost. It had more to do with making sense of one's life before one's life is over. Now, that sounds a little somber, but it's not really so. Because I remember that when I wrote about these things, it was also my extraordinary preoccupation with two unusual individuals that this civilization has given us, Tagore and Gandhi. So when I write about jazz and beer and Sada Dosa, it's a way of telling myself that this is what takes me all over the world to speak about two individuals who matter most to me in my life. Now that's strange, isn't it? Now Gandhi wouldn't let me have my glass of beer, I know it for sure. He wouldn't approve my Levi jeans and Adidas shoes. He would say, Prabodh, it's a good idea to be Swadeshi. And Tagore would tell me, come on, let's get intoxicated with the world that we have inherited. And this is an unresolved crisis of the self that some of us will experience. And that's where it begins. And so when I returned from the US after 5 years of studies and hitchhiking and my mezcalito and my LSDs and all my charas and ganjas and of course some excellent philosophy and a few girlfriends and my virginity and all those things, you know, the Gujarati boy in the US and the most careful kind of American girl. And I've written extensively about these journeys. But when I came back, I realized I had to tell my story about Richard Nixon and me, and about Ginsberg and me, and about Kalba Devi and Kuleshwar, Bombay and me. And what is it to be a Gujarati, which takes me to Mohandas all the time. So here's the story in a poem. What I did was to use a meter, not a meter, but something that I heard as a child, which is known as Satyanarayan Nikatha, you know. And Satyanarayan Nikatha is an interesting mode of narrating. A katha is the right word. Okay, so here is how it goes. Je jagine aavyo che, je jagine aavyo che, udine dubine kudine, vanana khale saavle chine, varyo che potani paase, ena jagaranu shun. Je jagine aavyo che, udine udyo che, dubine dubyo che, muine mumo che,
अरखना गंजी फराक पहरी कुवावो खोदी निक्सनु नाक चढ़ावी दुकानों छोड़ी फरोशे पोता नी पासे एना जागरण मुशु नमः जागरण नमः शांति ओम शांति रातेली मातेली पणे खुणा मा फफड़ती शांति चलो पाछू आलानी गृह शांति पणे टू ध्यानमा राखजो जे जागीने आव्यो छे डूबीने डूब्यो छे मुईने मुवो छे
मला आता फक्त पहुडायचं आहे हवाईच्या कामुक नेहरा महासमुद्रावर आणि निवांतपणे प्यायचे माझ्या वैराग्याची चिळ मार्टी किंवा वोडका. समुद्र व आकाशा व्यतिरिक्त कसलंच प्रतिबिंब पडू द्यायचं नाहीये माझ्या टुरिस्ट सनग्लासेसवर. मला आता काहीच करायचं नाही. ज्या बायांबरोबर मी झोपलो होतो त्या कमानीसारख्या वाकल्या वार्धक्यामुळे माझे मित्र विरून अदृश्य झाले कुठेतरी ह्या नव्या अगम्य जगात. माझे एकेकाळीचे शत्रू झाले पोट सुटलेले दबेकरे थेरडे. त्यांचं क्रौर्य संपलंय त्यांच्या संधिवातात. मी एकेकाळी करायचो शत्रूंमध्ये मिसळून मित्रांचा घात, मित्रांमध्ये राहून शत्रूंची दगा करायचो. पण मला हल्ली शत्रू आणि मित्र CIA आणि KGB, FBI आणि अल कायदा, MI5 आणि ISI वगैरे मला फरक समजत नाहीसा झालाय. मला अगदी कळेल असं झालंय मैत्री आणि घातामधला फरक बहुतेक म्हातारा होत चाललं. मी केव्हाच परत केलाय राणीला माझा खून करण्याचा परवाना. मी केव्हाच सोडून दिलाय पाया फिकवण्याचा मूर्खपणा. मी सोडून दिलाय एकाकी रिकामेपणावरचे असले तात्पुरते उपाय. मी ज्यांना मारून टाकलं म्हणूनच मला बुडवायच्या उत्तेजित तरुणांच्या मधाळ श्वासांचा वास असलेल्या मदिरे माझ्या शीत युद्धाच्या कोमट आठवणी. मला आता कोणाचाही पाठलाग करायचा नाही. कोणत्याही गुप्त हेला मागे किंवा बाई मागे किंवा स्वतः मागेही धावायचं नाही. मला फक्त पडून राहायचंय या हवाईच्या बीचवर विकिनी घातलेल्या बायकांचे थरथरणारे गुळगुळी उत्तम पहात. मला आता फक्त शांतपणे घ्यायची आहे माझ्या मृत्यूची चव असलेली अलिप्त माटी. ट्रान्सलेशन ऑफ दिस जेम्स बॉन्ड अनाउन्सेस रिटायरमेंट. आय सिम्पली वॉन्ट टू स्ट्रेच आउट ऑन द वॉलोचिस ब्लू बीच ऑफ हवाई अँड क्वाइटली सिप द मार्टिनी ऑर द वॉडका ऑफ माय रिनन्सिएशन. Apart from the sea or the sky, I don't want anything mirrored in my tourist sunglasses. I don't want to do anything now. Age has arced, the women has left me like a bow. My friends have evaporated into this incomprehensible world. My one-time enemies have metamorphed into pot-bellied, asthmatic old men. Their malice melted down into their arthritic knees. Once, I used to give away my friends to my enemies. My enemies to my friends. These days, however, I can't tell friends from foes. The CIA from the KGB, FBI from the Al-Qaeda, MI5 from ISI, friendship from betrayal. Perhaps I've grown old. I have already returned my license to kill the queen. I have already given up the folly of picking up women. I have discontinued these makeshift remedies for desolation. Today, I am not sure whether those I killed were merely terrorists or fuckwits like me. I have sold off my rusted Beretta. I am dreadfully wary of blood. Today, I can't tell whether this damned blood is that of a villain or it's my own, or tomato ketchup from Hollywood. Yes, probably I have aged ungracefully. That's why I want to submerge the tepid memories of the Cold War in this liquor that is fragrant like the honeyed breath of aroused young women. I no longer intend to hound spies or women for myself at breakneck speed. I just want to recline on the beaches of Hawaii watching quivering smooth buttocks of bikini-clad women. I only want to sip peacefully my detached martini whose flavor is like that of death. Thank you.
Thank you, Sachin. I didn't know that after Skyfall, it was James Bond's fate to be a dirty old man, not even in Scotland, but in Hawaii. When did you write
it? Yeah, it's before Skyfall.
I know. But it's also interesting how...
6 or 7
years ago. I was also thinking it's very interesting as a counterpoint to, you know, something like Ulysses of Tennyson, where even though he's an old man, he wants to go on his next voyage. He's asking Telemachus to stay back. And so
Ulysses does feature in Skyfall.
He does.
Ulysses has a quotation.
He does indeed. So this is a very Indian James Bond, okay? And Hawaii sounds suspiciously like Goa. But on that note, on that note, I'll also offer a little piece of my writing. And then as we discussed, we're going to throw it open to you guys. You can come and say things. And if we have time, we'll end with one round of readings, short ones, okay? So what I want to offer is, you know, a part of this book I'm working on. It's called Identity's Last Secret. And I read from it yesterday, a little bit from it yesterday. So it's a kind of trans-genre book. It's got philosophy, poetry, it's got literary criticism, and it ends with a tantra, a modern tantra. But I'm not going to read the tantra. I hope that, you know, Mao Zedong will invite me again and I will read a part of the tantra after the book is out. But anyhow, so this is from the second part of this book, whose title is Why Be Happy When You Could Be in Love? And this is, in a sense, we're talking about intertexts. And it refers to this amazing book by Janet Winters, you know, Wintersson. If you know the book, we can talk about that later. You know, but I don't want to waste time in trying to gloss parts of what I want to read to you. But the basic point in this portion of this book is that no piece of writing is actually innocent, and that I'm not speaking from innocence or contamination, which is political, but more in terms of forensic innocence. Every piece of writing is a project or puzzle. Even a poem is an attempt not just to tell a story, but to meet a particular demand or find a solution to a certain problem. The predicament may have real-life origins, but in writing, it evolves into telltale textual trouble. So, what are the kinds of problems that, I'm skipping a lot because time is limited, but what are the kinds of problems that writing tries to solve? And here's an example from Hanif Qureshi and the start of his book, Something to Tell You. Why is love difficult, sex complicated, living painful, and death so close and yet placed far away? Why are pleasure and punishment closely related? How do our bodies speak? Why do we make ourselves ill? Why do you want to fail? Why is pleasure so hard to bear? So, I propose in this part of my book that writing, we write to solve these puzzles. You know? And these puzzles, of course, after being solved, are never solved because they keep coming back in a different form. And so I'm going to skip a lot and to offer, I don't know if I can offer you a solution, but let me see. And in passing, I want to, speaking of my intertext, tell you something, which is a clue that the title Identity's Last Secret comes from the 12th chapter, translating into English, since this event is so much about translation, of Gayatri Chakravarti Spivak's book, Aesthetic Education in an Era of Globalization. Of her 25 books, it is this one that is perhaps the most deeply felt and moving, the harvest of a quarter century of enunciation and performance. It actively pursues a distracted theory of the double mind. She founded Spivak claims in the suggestion that the humanities can somehow learn to resolve double minds by playing them. So here's the clue. The identity's last secret, in a way, is about this mad poet called Binoy Mojumdar, who was in love with GALF Spivak when she was 18 years old and a student of Residency College for Kolkata. And he wrote a book of poems on her, and he changed the title. The first title was Gayatri Day, and then it was too revealing, so he changed it to Pire Esho Chaka. Now, Pire Esho means come back, and Chaka is a wheel, but it's a pun on Chakravarti. You see, Chakravarti is the one who holds the wheel as a conqueror. But, so I tell the story of this failed love affair of this mad poet, who is mad literally, he went in and out of asylums. And I use it as a way to unpack Spivak's distracted theory of reading. But also in the passing, I might tell you that it's also interesting that there's another book which was actually written to Spivak, which was by her first husband, Mr. Spivak, in which she also features. And there's a third text in which she features in not so complimentary a way, and that is Rukun Advani's Beta One Among the Cows, where a famous off-quoted jibe runs as follows: Professor Laventry, all theories collected, Marx's phone calls, had outsold, gone with the wind. Her collected feminist faxes was in press. Her opponents defined her subject position with a law, Laventry's law. Incredible articulation plus incredible incomprehension equals incredible salary. The character appeared earlier in 1993 as Professor Laventry, speed hack in a slim booklet called Indian History from Above and Below, published from Lucknow by Rukun Advani's father, Ram Advani, a respected bookseller whose well-frequented premises in Hazrat Ganj are still popular among the youth. So the book is full of these tittle-tattle tales, but here's the point. I'm coming to the point very quickly now and ending my part of the reading, which is this: that how do you reach the crux of the problem which you want to solve? And you reach it through a blood trail that leads to the wound. To that gash he had to find his way. That was the solution to the real and narrative problem. And this is how the solution starts offering it itself both to the writer and to the reader. And I'll end with this short excerpt. Like a shell, not on a beach, but carried far inland on a dried riverbed, the river changed course 1,000 years ago, then lost itself in the desert wastes. Still, how wide its banks, how deep the gorge, where it had cut itself through rock and soil. No, nothing more than sandy desolation, an immense scar on the face of the earth, seen even in satellite images, a wound marked on a land parched for hundreds of miles. Yet, these fossil traces, powdery bones of creatures once pulsating with life, little shells bleached white, drying in the harsh sun, brittle and crumbling to powdery dust at the slightest touch. Still, once in a while, a rare, almost perfect shell, so fragile, so singular, so pure. Pick it up and hold it to your ear. The echo of water, though faint and distant, not entirely lost. There was a river here once. It fertilized the fields, fed the land. It flowed down to the sea. We can never return to the womb of our first mother, from where we were pushed out into the cruel world. A mother herself turning against us, muttering, wrong baby, if not wrong crib. But to a cosmic mother's womb, which births the stars and galaxies, our return is fated. The empty shell, with its echo of water, sings, rain, rain. Perhaps it will rain. Perhaps the river will flow again. And if there is a river, there must be the ocean. That, like the primal waters from which life emerged, is our home. Like a curse, like a blessing. You don't have to think, you write, the words come to you. And so, my friends, this is that hidden river which always runs aground, the river Saraswati, from which the Saraswats who populated Goa are also supposed to have come from. But it's always available if you know how to dig deep. And in that dry riverbed, you'll find the perfect shell which will give you the clue to the secret that you're trying to unravel, because it carries the smell of rain and the promise of the ocean. Thank you. So now, thank you.